How does addiction work? Let's start by asking the question, what causes addiction? That's a question that we've been told since childhood. It comes down to only one thing. If you use or do something addictive, you will become addicted. This is the message taught in programs like DARE and other substance abuse prevention education programs. Millions of school children from 1983 to 2009 took part in these programs. After decades of study showed that DARE was ineffective at preventing drug abuse, they officially replaced the curriculum and now call it keeping it real. Time will tell if the changes were effective. In reality, just because someone uses something like an addictive drug does not necessarily mean they will become addicted. A Cochrane review of prescribing opioids for chronic pain found that less than 1% of well-screened patients developed a new addiction. All drugs are not the same. They range in physical and psychological dangers from ones with almost no adverse effects to ones that will quickly cause a dangerous binding addiction. DARE taught that all drugs were equally bad. When a child sees a parent, friend, or family member use a substance like cannabis without any adverse effects, they will start to ignore all information taught about the legitimate dangers and consequences of substances like opioids. There has never been a single death from overdosing on cannabis in all of human history. There were 33,000 deaths from opioids in 2015 alone. This video will help explain how addictive behavior is chemically formed in the brain. The focus here will be on addiction to illegal drugs like opioids, but the same mechanisms affect other addictive behaviors like sexual, gambling, and thrill-seeking. In many cases, the words opiate and opioid are used interchangeably. An opiate is any of the naturally occurring alkaloids found in the opium poppy, like morphine, codeine, and thebaine. An opioid is any of the natural or synthetic alkaloids found in the opium poppy. This is a newer term that includes all man-made alkaloids like oxycodone and fentanyl, in addition to the opiates mentioned previously. Think of it the same as how a tree is a plant, but not all plants are trees. Opioids work by increasing levels of the brain's reward neurotransmitter, dopamine. Neurotransmitters are the chemical messengers in the nervous system that send signals between a neuron and another cell. If your brain needs to send a message to another part of the brain or body, the message is sent with neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters send the signal that tells your heart to beat, your lungs to breathe, and your stomach to digest food. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter that plays a key role in the brain's reward system. Dopamine is released normally into the brain as a way to create feelings of pleasure, to reward behavior that is responsible for necessary life functions like eating and drinking, exercise, and procreation. How do opioids work? The brain is built from a collection of over 100 billion cells called neurons. People affectionately call them brain cells. Neurons are the specialized cells that transmit information throughout the brain to another neuron, muscle, or gland cell. The brain communicates with itself and other parts of the body through a vast network of interconnected neurons. To properly understand how opioids work in the brain, we should first review this animation of how the brain functions without opioids. A package of the neurotransmitter GABA is created, called the synaptic vesicle. Without the influence of opioids, nothing is limiting the GABA package, so a full load is created. The GABA package moves down and binds with the neuron wall. The GABA moves across the space between the neurons, called the synapse, and binds with the GABA receptors on the presynaptic neuron. The presynaptic neuron is the brain cell that is sending the message. A synaptic vesicle package of the neurotransmitter dopamine is created. Without opioids to artificially limit the GABA, a normal-sized package of dopamine is created. The dopamine package moves down and binds with the neuron wall. Dopamine is released. It passes the synapse and binds with the dopamine receptors on the postsynaptic neuron. The postsynaptic neuron is the brain cell that is receiving the message. After the dopamine is sent to the receiving neuron, the synaptic vesicle that delivered it will detach from the wall and move to the dopamine transporter. In a fraction of a second, the message has been sent, and the brain will then recover the neurotransmitters for later use. The dopamine then detaches from the dopamine receptors, passes back across the space between the neurons, enters the dopamine transporter, and is reabsorbed into the dopamine synaptic vesicle. The dopamine synaptic vesicle then moves back up the neuron to prepare for the next signal. The GABA then detaches from the GABA receptor, passes back across the synapse, enters the GABA transporter, and is reabsorbed into the GABA synaptic vesicle. The GABA synaptic vesicle then moves back up the neuron to prepare for the next signal. Now that we have an understanding of how the brain's neurons function normally, let's take a look at what happens when opioids are ingested. Opioids are absorbed into the bloodstream, where they pass through the blood-brain barrier and enter the brain. Once in the brain, the opioids bind to mu receptors on the GABA neuron. Opioids bind to these receptors because they mimic the body's natural hormone, endorphin. Under normal circumstances, pain moves through this neuron. When opioids bind to receptors on the GABA neuron, they slow the transmission of the pain signal, which results in pain relief. As a result of the opioids, a much smaller than normal package of the neurotransmitter GABA is created, called the synaptic vesicle. The GABA package moves down and binds with the neuron wall. The GABA moves across the space between the neurons, called the synapse, and binds with the GABA receptors on the presynaptic neuron. The presynaptic neuron being the one sending the message. The opioids block the release of most of the GABA, which in turn causes the presynaptic neuron to create a larger than normal synaptic vesicle package of the neurotransmitter dopamine. The dopamine package moves down and binds with the neuron wall. Because of the opioids, a massive dose of dopamine is released, and it passes the synapse and binds with the dopamine receptors on the postsynaptic neuron. The postsynaptic neuron being the brain cell receiving the message. It is this massive flood of dopamine that causes the feelings of euphoria that helps drive the use of opioids. After the dopamine is sent to the receiving neuron, the synaptic vesicle that delivered it will detach from the wall and move to the dopamine transporter. In a fraction of a second, the message has been sent, and the brain will recover the neurotransmitters for later use. The dopamine then detaches from the dopamine receptors, passes back across the space between the neurons called the synapse, enters the dopamine transporter, and is reabsorbed into the dopamine synaptic vesicle. The dopamine synaptic vesicle then moves back up the neuron to prepare for the next signal. The GABA then detaches from the GABA receptors and passes back across the synapse, enters the GABA transporter, and is reabsorbed into the GABA synaptic vesicle. The GABA synaptic vesicle then moves back up the neuron to prepare for the next signal. It is the use of opioids that triggers the massive release of dopamine that causes the desirable feelings of euphoria and intense pleasure. The brain comes to expect and demand this regular flood of pleasurable dopamine. The brain doesn't crave opioids, the brain craves dopamine. When the overstimulation of the opioid receptors stops, the excess dopamine stops, and the user is left with painful withdrawal symptoms. These symptoms are supposed to be a message to the brain to return to the activity that was providing it with dopamine. Let's take a look at the difference between natural and artificial sources of dopamine. Natural dopamine sources, like eating and drinking, exercise, and procreation, produce a normal amount of dopamine. Natural sources create enough dopamine to make the brain want to repeat the behavior, but not so much as to make the brain overly focused on that single behavior at the detriment to all others. In contrast, artificial sources create so much dopamine that the brain disregards the natural sources and focuses almost exclusively on the artificial source. Opioids produce up to 10 times the amount of dopamine as natural sources, which is why the withdrawal symptoms from them are so much more intense. When opioid use stops, dopamine levels quickly fall. The brain recognizes this abrupt drop in dopamine and responds by creating painful withdrawal symptoms. The combination of on-demand euphoria, combined with the need to avoid the withdrawal symptoms, causes someone to become addicted and stay addicted. Acute opioid withdrawal is the term given to symptoms that typically start 6 to 16 hours after the last dose. Early symptoms that typically occur in the first 24 hours include anxiety and restlessness, eyes tearing up, runny nose, excessive sweating, inability to sleep, frequent yawning, and muscle aches. Symptoms get more intense after 24 hours and include rapid heartbeat and high blood pressure, nausea and vomiting, diarrhea and abdominal pain, dilated pupils, and possibly blurry vision. Someone using opioids over an extended period of time will find that the same dose that once got them high is no longer having the same effect. This reduced response to the same level of stimulation is known as tolerance. It is this tolerance that causes someone addicted to opioids to keep increasing the dose over time. Tolerance develops because of an internal struggle in the brain, over one part trying to reward the use of the dopamine-elevating opioids, and another part that recognizes and tries to correct the overabundance in two ways. Primarily, the brain will reduce the amount of dopamine that it produces each time it's stimulated. Secondly, the brain reduces the amount of dopamine it produces naturally to reward for necessary life activities. This means that the brain will favor rewarding the exceptionally high dopamine levels associated with opioids over the natural dopamine levels produced from activities like eating, drinking, and sleeping. Over time, this will reduce the drive for behavior that is necessary for survival and direct it entirely to opioids. It is this reduced reward for necessary functions that causes some of the depression that so often accompanies addiction. The longer a person has been using an opioid, the longer it will take after use has ended before normal dopamine levels and function return. If the length of uninterrupted opioid use does not exceed a couple of weeks, then severe withdrawal symptoms are unlikely. When ending the use of opioids, the acute physical withdrawal symptoms might only last a few days to a couple of weeks, but normal dopamine and pleasure might not return for 6 months to several years. The longer the high dopamine levels last, the longer it will take to fully return to normal. The second stage of withdrawal is called post-acute withdrawal syndrome, or POS. Post-acute withdrawal syndrome is the name for the symptoms that begin after acute withdrawal symptoms end. These symptoms include anxiety, insomnia and low enthusiasm, fatigue, irritability, concentration problems, and depression. These symptoms often present as severe mood swings. Post-acute withdrawal symptoms are why so many people go to rehab and stop using opioids, only to go home depressed for months or years and relapse. This is the time when someone recovering from addiction needs the help of family or friends the most. Relapsing after acute physical withdrawal symptoms end is very dangerous because someone doesn't have the same tolerance as before, which can result in a fatal overdose, even when using the same dose that they used daily just weeks prior. Someone addicted to opioids isn't really cured until they have stopped using long enough for dopamine levels to return to normal. If this was made more clear, and more effort was put into treating until normal function returned, we would likely have much better outcomes. This should have helped explain why the drive to use drugs, or other addictive behavior, can be so completely consuming. This isn't just someone wanting to use the opioid. This is the most primal driving force for all life on Earth that's compelling them to use it. It's not a choice. It's a chemical imbalance driving the user to never change. Understanding how addiction works can be the first step to ending it. Helping family understand addiction can make all the difference for a successful, lasting recovery. Do you know someone dealing with an opioid addiction, or a family member of someone who is? Share this video with them to help. If you found the content helpful, please give this video a thumbs up. If you like what you see and want to see more, please subscribe to this channel by selecting the subscribe button. Did this video help your understanding of how addiction works? Do you have any suggestions or changes that would help make this video even more helpful, clear, or informative? Do you have a personal experience with addiction?